And there is a special proof mark for the screw-in chokes. It's on the breech somewhere, and I can't remember for the life of me where it is. Now then, so you've got a lot to learn about proof marks if you get into that. Like I say, it doesn't apply to America because we have no proof, we have no rules of proof, and so we should have, but we never will have. Because if we try to get proof houses set up, the anti-gun people would jump on that just like that. They'd use that as a tool to ban guns. They'd be saying, you know, you're making guns that are unsafe and all that kind of thing. Once you've started trying to get a proof house, I wish we could get a proof house or some proof houses, because I tell you, it would really protect us as gunsmiths in what we're doing. And also, it would prevent a lot of these unscrupulous dealers selling unsafe guns. Because right now, we've got dealers in this country selling guns which are death traps. And I'll quote an instance of one dealer years ago sent me a Purdy gun to restock. And I looked at the barrels, and they were so badly pitted, and the pits were so deep, a spider could have hidden in the pits and you wouldn't have seen it. And I called the dealer, I said to him, look, I said, you're crazy having this restock. The barrels are no good, they're scrap. And he said, don't you worry about that, you just restock it. He said, I can send those barrels to Joe Blow up in Connecticut, and he'll bore it. Every pit out of that barrel, and he'll get those barrels perfect. I said, yeah. And I said, they'll be as thin as paper. I said, and the gun will be unsafe. Ah, he said, it'll be all right. Well, I restocked his gun, sent it back to him, got me money, I'm happy. And then one day, a customer of mine called me, and he said, he was overjoyed. He said, I bought a Purdy. And he said, I want the stock altered. Okay, send it along. Well, he did. He sent it along, and I took it out the box. I recognised it straight away because it was my stock. I recognised the gun. I wrapped it up straight away, sent it back to him, and said, "You haven't shot it, have you?" He said, "No." I said, "Well, don't." I said, "It's a death trap. It'll kill you." And anyway, he said, "Well, thanks for the good advice," and he sold it or got rid of it. I went to the Byfield show at Vegas that following winter, and I'm walking around the show, walking past the table. Good God, there's that Purdy again. Some other dealer had got it. I had a look at it. Nobody had shot it, but because it was still perfect. There was a mark in the barrel. I put it, the dealer said, well, what do you think? I said, not a great deal. I put it down and walked away. I don't know whatever happened to it. And another thing, I'll tell you another shocking incident. A certain dealer, actually it was the same one I did the stock for, called me and he said, I've got a customer interested in a Boss that I've got. The customer he got was an old customer of mine. And he called me and he said, would you mind having a look at a Boss for me? I said, I don't mind. Well, anyway, the dealer called me and he said, Jack, if the guy buys this gun, he said, there's $500 in it for you. I said, well, I don't need your money. I said, I'll give a honest opinion, you know. Well, he sent the gun to me, and on the flats of the barrels, so this is the, well, here's the one lump, the other lump, and all the proof marks are just on this part here. I took the barrels off, and you got there 0.729, 0.729 there, and all the rest of the proof marks down here were all fake. The one that threw one amongst them, they'd all been stamped, of some homemade punches and stamped in. Oh, look at that. I thought, good God, it's all fake proof marks. So, well, what's going on? This is right. It looks right because when a gun goes into the proof house, first thing they do is measure the bores and put the bore size on. That was in the under the old rules of proof of 1954. So that was correct. All these were fake. I thought, well, wonder what's going on here. Now the gun had been, the woodwork had been done up. The whole lot had been softened and re-engraved and re-hardened. I mean, it looked $1 million to the average fella, but the dealer was asking 11,000 bucks for it. Well, you won't get a good boss for 11,000 bucks. So I took the one of the locks out, and then I spotted what had happened. What in the corner of the action where the standing breech is, this is a standing breech, this corner was more rounded than normal because normally they've got a very small radius in the corner. Now this had a more larger radius. I took a lock out and right underneath, under here where the bar of the lock fits into the bar of the action, right under here you could see the weld. Somebody had welded the corner. What had happened with this gun? It was an old boss and somebody had sent it to somebody in Birmingham to fit new barrels. They'd fitted the barrels, sent it to the proof house. The proof house had put 720 in the bore size on, shot the thing, and the action had cracked. I've seen them crack before, cracked right in the corner. Well, the proof house, normally with a proof failure, they deface the proof marks. They don't deface the bore size. Now, with this case, there was, because it was new barrels, they'd put that on, there was no proof, old proof marks. So what they did then was just left it like that, put a ticket on it saying proof reject, give it back to the gun maker. And obviously he'd put it in the corner or whatever and forgot about it. And somebody had gone along and said, how much do you want for that? Bought it off him, welded the corner, tarted the whole gun up, and it had come over to America. This dealer's trying to sell it. Well, anyway, the customer called me. He said, well, what do you think? I said, don't touch it. It's a death trap. Well, I wouldn't shoot it. No, with a welded corner like that. So anyway, the dealer called me. He said, is he going for it? I said, no. I said, you can't sell a gun like that. It's disgraceful. I said, it's cracked through the corner. It's a death trap. He said, that gun's all right. Safe as houses. I said, BS. Anyway, that was the last I heard of it. I sent it back to the dealer. A year later, a veterinarian in Tulsa called me and he said, Jack, I've got found a gun, a boss. He said, 9,000. He said, will you have a look at it? I said, sure. Well, he got a certain gun shop to ship it to me and he shipped in a long box, assembled. I opened the end of the box and slid it out, and as it come out, when I got to shut it back in quick, it's the same damn gun. So I called the veterinarian and I said, don't touch that thing with a 10-foot pole, it's a death trap. Well, he said, well, thank you very much for telling me. He said, you'll certainly find out who your friends are. Well, some dealer who's now not there in Springfield, Missouri, tried to sell it to him. But again, you know, this is the sort of thing that goes on. And I mean, you've got to watch out for this kind of thing because, I mean, you repair a gun that's been messed with like that and something happens afterwards, it's likely that the guy who sent you the gun is going to come after you.